I spent a little over 25 years in the ministry, traveling and going all over the place, all over the country, other countries and such. And then the Lord led me to move to Florida, and I pastored here for a while. And then I stopped that at the Lord's leading and just started writing some. So for like the last 3 or 4 years, I've just been kind of a slug laying around and writing and doing things, and not really doing a whole lot of ministry other than the writing. And a couple months ago, I was playing the keyboard over at the Coastal Life on A1A and Stuart there, and the Lord spoke to me. I like to say it this way: the word of the Lord came to me. Doesn't that sound cool? I'm just sitting there, and I felt His presence all around me, and I'm looking at other people thinking, I wonder if they feel this. And it was just like a blanket almost. And I heard God say to me, make yourself ready. And when God speaks to you, I don't know if you've ever experienced that, he usually injects some understanding with it. And I knew what He meant. I knew He was going to have me speaking again and going to wherever. And I said, okay. And you know, and when you're in the ministry, it's kind of like ministry is like going into the fighting ring a lot of times. I mean, you can lay around and get fat and lazy and out of shape, and then when you have a bout coming up, you have to go and get ready and get into it and be ready for it, because it's not something you can just take casually. So I've been getting ready, and I'm ready. And then Pastor Todd came to me and Joe and asked me. Actually, they called me to a breakfast, and I thought it was just going to be Todd, and we were just going to fellowship. And then when I got there, I saw more than one place setting, and I knew that somebody else was going to be there. And I thought, well, I'm either going to get rebuked, or they're going to ask me to speak. So and sure enough, they did. So and then he asked me to come up here, and you know, we could go on and on about that, but I'm just glad to be here, and I'm going to be sharing from some of my experiences in traveling and winning souls, because we're going to get into that just a little bit. But let's pray first. Lord, we love You and we thank You. We give You glory. And Father, I pray that You have something to say through me for every person here. I pray that every person receives something directly from You, even though You're using my mouth and maybe whatever else You want to do here, Lord God, but I pray that You touch every person, that they leave here feeling like God spoke to them, and that they would be built up, they would be encouraged, they'd be full of faith, and they'd be ready. We thank You for that, Lord. And we believe You for it. In the name of Jesus. Open your smartphone Bible apps to the book of Revelation. We're doing a series, the churches are doing a series on revive, and I started praying about that. I wanted to be in step with that, of course. Nobody told me what to say, and several days ago, I was seeking the Lord about it, and He led me to the book of Revelation, first part of it, and started showing me some things. And now we're all familiar with these things that Jesus said to the church. I'm sure you've probably heard them before. But the thing that jumped out at me, I'm just going to start. I was going to save it for the end, but I'm just going to go ahead and start with it. Let me get my glasses. It's chapter 3. Verse 19. Now, this is after Jesus had addressed them and covered a number of things. Things that he was dissatisfied. Some major things, some minor things. And as you know, now a lot of people believe that these churches are representative of time frame. You know, like the early church and then this church and then Laodicea is the Latter-day Church and all that. I personally don't subscribe to that thinking. It may be right, but I think it was just churches that were in existence then, because all of these things that you find in here, we can find anywhere today. If you know, I've been in churches that are on fire for God. You walk in and the presence of God hits you when you walk in the door and people are winning souls. And I've been to churches that are just, you know, you wonder if they just got up from a nap and they're arguing about the carpet. You can find everything, the whole spectrum. And Jesus, he always started off by encouraging them, but then he said, I have something against you. And then he had some pretty strong warnings about some stuff. And I'm not going to get into those. You could spend, each one of them can be a whole sermon, I guess. But they were very serious. Jesus didn't joke around a whole lot like we do. Now, I know God has a sense of humor. I've had him joke with me before. And we're made in his image. But you don't see him jesting and doing a lot of things in the scripture. But he does like to have fun. I was in a service over in Tampa. This has been a month ago, 2 months maybe. And I had been in 3 in a row, and everyone that I went to, and I don't want to sound ugly, but I ended up sitting next to people that didn't smell so good, okay? Now, it was an international meeting, and there were people from other countries, and not everybody has the standards that we have and all that, and it was really distracting because it was a very strong thing that I was experiencing, kind of yanked me out of the spirit. And I'm trying to love everybody, and God loves everybody. I know you all have experienced these kind of things. Don't look at me like I'm being mean or something. And so after a couple of those services, it happened 2 or 3 times in a row, I finally thought, I'm going to pray about my next seat. So, because I want to enjoy the service. So I said, God, I know you love everybody. And I love these people too, but would you please put me next to somebody that doesn't smell bad? Now this is just a private thing, okay? So I said, amen. I went to the service. This usher took me to a seat. I sat down. I'm enjoying myself. After about 10 minutes, here comes this lady with a big hat on, this big flowing flowery dress, and she sat down and she must have had a gallon of perfume on. I mean, there was no oxygen within 10 feet of the whole area we're sitting, and I just said, okay, real funny, God. I don't know why I thought of that, but anyway, God has fun with me sometimes, and I'm sure he does you too. But this verse 19, Jesus says, as many as I love, I rebuke. I rebuke. Now, I looked that word up. You know, it means to correct, it means to challenge, it means to punish even, but as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. And then he said this. Now, because I this verse just hit me, because so much of the time we want the Lord to revive us. We want the Lord to do this. God, make me do this and renew my mind. We used to sing a song like that, Lord, renew my mind. He's not going to renew your mind. If God was going to renew your mind, he would have done it already. And if he was going to make us, if he was going to force us to be zealous, he would have done it before you got here. But so much of what we have to do to condition ourselves and be ready, we have to do ourselves. There's so much of that. God has given us a tremendous amount of authority, a tremendous amount of choice. And he said this, he said, be zealous. Be zealous. So the key to your revival now is really with you. And you may not even need revival. I mean, you're here already. There's a good chance that you're already revived. We really shouldn't need it. We are supposed to be dispensers of revival. We're supposed to be revived, and we, you know, the word means to bring back to life. And we're supposed to go to people, and we're supposed to bring them back to life. And you can't give what you don't have, so we're supposed to be ready. But but things happen, and you know, we kind of drift, and like he mentions in one of these places that you've left your first love. And you know, it's just like a relationship. You have a relationship, and they start. It starts all lovey-dovey, and let's say the woman is sitting right next to the man on the next in the car, and they're holding. And then after a few years, she's kind of hugging the door over here. And we can get that way, and do we just take things for granted? And you, in a relationship, you have to purposely make things alive, right? Some of you, I guess so. But yeah, you do. Okay, you have to work at it. And he says, be zealous. You can make the choice to be zealous. I don't think Christians think about this much, but do you know faith is a choice? Almost everything about faith is a choice. I've done a lot of witnessing. We used to go door to door a lot and go on street witnessing and all that. And you'll share something that you know you want people to understand. And they'll say, well, I don't believe it like that. And that's okay. Everybody has a way that they can believe something. But they chose to not believe it. You can choose to believe. You can change the way you think. You may have a problem with any subject, healing or whatever. You could maybe you brought up where we don't believe it that way. We don't believe in healing. Well, you can stop that and start saying, you know what? I'm going to believe in healing. It's a choice. I believe God can do this. Jesus did it all the time, so I'm going to believe that way. It's a choice. Zeal is the same way. You can choose to be zealous. Now, we have, I'm discussing with some of the other guys in ministry at the church there, and we were talking about different people who had gotten away from God and come back to God, and, you know, like David and different ones, and all of those are very, very, very good, needy stories. I love to do those things. But as I was thinking, the thing that has revived me the most in years gone by is leading somebody to the Lord. You go out and you find somebody and get them saved, and you'll feel like you got saved yourself. And so many Christians don't spend their time doing that. Now, I don't feel like it. I'm busy. I'm this, that, or the other thing. I don't know how. I'm nervous. I'm afraid. Well, all of that stuff will go away as soon as you get into it, and if you get used to it. It's like anything. It's just like, you know, you start a new job, you're a little nervous at first. After a while, you're not. You start driving your car. We were all nervous about that. But, you know, you're a little nervous. And after a little while, you don't even think about it. Second nature. The fear goes away. Everything you get from God grows. Boldness grows. You may think, well, I'm not a bold person. Most of the people I've ever met in ministry weren't either when they started. I know I wasn't. I mean, when I was in high school, they said, you have to do an oral report. And I said, no, I'm not going to do that. Well, you'll get an F. I said, give me the F. I'm not doing it. And I didn't do it. And they gave me the F. They meant it, and I meant it. And I never did that. I don't know why we're terrified of that. I'm a bit nervous today because I haven't been used to it. But that's the same with soul winning. If you get out of the habit of it, you have to overcome that nervousness again. But I got there to a point when I was traveling in ministries all the time, I never thought about that. I couldn't wait to get out there. There was no nervousness whatsoever because I was used to it and I was doing it all the time. And boldness is like that. And I can't think of anything that we do for God that doesn't require boldness. Boldness will grow. You know, if you're going to sing, you have to be a little bit bold. If you're going to minister in the gifts of the Spirit, you have to be bold. If you're going to do this, you have to have some boldness. You have to overcome and develop some sort of boldness. You can do that with witnessing as well. If you'll just start with a little thing, like maybe giving somebody a track. I started putting them on cars. I was too chicken to even hand one to somebody. I found out how easy it is to do by putting these things on cars. I remember I put one behind a windshield wiper, and I walked away, and this lady came walking up. This was in an indoor parking lot. I don't know. Downtown Louisville, Kentucky, I think that's where I'm from. And this lady came walking up, and took the track off of the windshield and called to me. I'm about four cars away because I'm trying to get away, really. I saw her coming. And she said, "I believe already." So I went walking back to her. And I said, "You do?" She said, "Yes." And I said, "Have you been born again yet?" She said, "No, not yet." I said, "Do you know what it is?" She said, "Yes." Then I used some really profound wisdom. I said, "Would you like to be?" And she said, "You know, I would." That was the whole conversation. I'm standing there thinking, this is too easy. I got to go get a Bible and read or something, or do something. Now, some people say you can't just pray that easy and get saved, but you can. "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that he's raised from the dead." Now, she already had been set up. She was already primed. She was already what I like to call ripe. And she knew what she was doing. And she just hadn't done it. It's like preparing for marriage. You can think about it and you can want to be married, but you know, you're not married until you say, "I do." Until you make that commitment. I grew up in church believing in God all my life, but I never had been born again. I didn't even hear about being born again until I was 22. I believe God existed. So does the devil. I believed that, you know, the stories. I went to the Bible school, the Sunday school, and all that kind of thing, but I didn't know him. You know, you can believe in McDonald's and never eat there. And you'd probably be better off. But anyway, you could say, "I believe in McDonald's," and I could go and buy you a Big Mac and put it right in front of you. You can say, "I believe Bruce even bought me a Big Mac, that it's real. And it's all real. I believe all that." And not eat it. Push it aside. And see, salvation is just like that. You can believe that God is real. You can believe that you can even believe Jesus is raised from the dead. The devil believes that. But not receive it. Not receive him. Not get him into you. Because God is a gentleman. He doesn't just come into your life uninvited. He'll try to woo you. He'll try to reach you. He'll do all kinds of things. Some of you remember when God was after you. It's like every bumper sticker in the world was about Jesus. And you turn on television and they're saying, "You need Jesus." And you know, you're under the gun, Jesus is after you. And he does that, but he won't make you do anything. He won't make you be zealous. He won't make you come to him. And he said, "Be zealous, therefore, and repent." That word repent means become new. One of its meanings means change. It means think differently. It means make things new. Now, we have the opportunity to do that every day. All things are new. What does the Bible say? His mercies are tender, and his mercies are new every day, however that verse goes. We get to start over. And every minute, really. You know, you mess up, you can stop and say, "Jesus, forgive me," and you can get right back into it. But you can choose to be zealous. And I'm going to suggest this to everybody in here, that you set a goal and say, "I am determined, I'm going to go find somebody and I'm going to get somebody saved this week." You can be really bold and say it today. It's not hard to find sinners. It's not hard to find ripe sinners. I love that. You know, Jesus likes things easy too. He said, "Which is it easier for me to say, your sins are forgiven, or rise up?" He was looking for the easy way there. Now, you know, I can't say that about everything he did, because certainly the cross wasn't easy, but it was the only way, and he did it. But he makes things easy. There's three ways to do things. There's the right way, there's the wrong way, and there's the let God help you way. You know, the right way, I'm in real estate. The right way, I can go and spend all of my time prospecting and looking and working and doing all the things that they say we should do, and all that stuff's good. But I don't do that because I didn't want to make a religion out of it and it consumed my whole life. So what I do is I let God help me. I was telling some of them this morning before we started, I was working at our church in Palm City and I heard some lady in one of the houses across the street yell to her neighbor, "I'm going to have to sell my house after all." So me being the greedy capitalist that I am, I went walking over there and started talking to her. That planted a seed, And then a few weeks later, or actually about a month later, she called me and said, I want you to do this for me. So I went over there to her house. I listed the house, showed the house, and sold the house all in one day. I don't have that kind of skill. I just asked God, help me do this. Help me get, you know, something on the books here. And that's easy. Now, I said that to say this. He does that with people that you can lead to Him. They're out there looking for God. And there are examples in the Bible of that. Remember the Holy Spirit told Philip to go join yourself to the chariot. What did he find when he got there? The guy was reading the Bible. Everybody say easy. Paul, he's going to, where is it, Ephesus or somewhere, I forget. He runs into 12 guys and he says, have you all received the Holy Spirit since you believed? They were ready. Nobody argued with him. See, we all have the idea that everybody's going to want to argue with us and fight us. And that happens sometimes. But I still pray this way. I say, Lord, show me somebody easy. I don't feel like arguing. And he can do that. The Holy Spirit is inside of you looking through your eyes. He really is. You need to, if you're not aware of that, you need to be aware of that, and you need to start sensing that. You need to purposely start realizing that He's doing that, and maybe He is, if somebody's catching your attention, maybe it's Him trying to get you to look at them. And He does that. If you say this, Lord, and I hope everybody does this today, God, show me somebody that's ready and ripe. I ask you to signal me some way. Let me find somebody. Lead me to them or lead them to me. See, I used to do a lot of traveling and Jesus said, go ye. But, you know, I did more ministry as I went. He said, go ye, but as you go, preach. You know, God can set up things and the only thing you have to do is be ready. He arranges things. He tries. Now, if you're not ready and you're not going to do it and you don't care, He's not going to probably bother. But if you want Him to, He'll set up situations for you and you'll walk right into them. I could stand here for a week telling you stories. Some of you have those stories. I went up to Battle Creek, Michigan. I had a cousin up there who pastored a church and he asked me to come up and speak. No, he wasn't a pastor. He was an associate. There's another fellow that was a pastor. And I said, we should go out door to door. I used to do that a lot with churches. And of course, nobody wanted to do it. But I convinced them to do it. I said, it's easy. You know, what we have to not do is spend time with people that are not interested. If they're not interested, we just go to the next house and then the next house. Or we just find people who are interested. We don't have to push, argue, do any of that stuff. Sometimes you do, but you can look for the ripe ones. They finally said, okay. Well, a couple of us, I was with the pastor and somebody else, we ended up downtown somewhere or another. I'm not sure how. And this fellow was coming walking down the sidewalk. And I stopped him and I said, let me ask you something real quick. Do you ever think about asking Jesus into your life? I gave him a track. He said, well, I have thought about it some. And I said, have you ever heard of being born again? He said, I've been trying to find somebody to explain that to me for a year. I'm not kidding. That's exactly what he said. And the pastor was standing there, and he couldn't believe how easy it was. And I used to be like that too. You don't know how easy until you get out there and you find them. They're everywhere. Every time you go to the bank, the grocery store, or anywhere, when you pass people, somebody is ripe. Now, I'm not saying you have to stop everybody, but let God set something up for you. And then when your attention is drawn to somebody, I mean, it's just like on the inside of you, it's like, do, 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 do. The Holy Spirit, it's, you know, you can read about that in the Bible. Remember, Peter's eyes were fixed on the guy at the gate. That was the Holy Spirit doing that. You know, Christians always wonder, where are all the miracles? They're in all the places we avoid. You've got to get into something where you need one. And if you go looking for people and you find somebody that needs some help, you might have a miracle. I'm amazed at some of the things that I've seen happen, because not because of me, but because God loves people so much and He wants to save them. See, Jesus' first love is us and saving people and touching people and reaching. Jesus' first love is keeping people out of hell. And that should be our first love. That's probably what everybody is interested in when they first get saved. And he said, you know, in one place he said, remember where you have fallen and go back and do the things you used to do. Because we get so busy with this, that, and the other thing. We get so caught up in the religious aspect of stuff. And Satan's a master at wasting our time. So make it a priority to say to God, I want you to show me someone. Do it every day. How many people here now? Maybe I shouldn't ask. I don't know. I don't want to embarrass anybody. How many have led somebody to the Lord in the last 7 days? Good. Last 2 weeks? Good. Okay, now I'm not trying to make everybody feel bad. I'm not. Two there. When how many people were in here, and there's probably at least one opportunity per day, I would think, somewhere, if you're looking for it. It's, you know, if you've got 100 people, I don't think we have that anyway. We got 50 or 60 in here, I don't know. If you have 100 people and everybody misses an opportunity for a week every day, that's 700 opportunities. Simply because we're not busy looking. Now, I know what it's like. I've missed 1,000 opportunities myself. I walked by. I got so tired of saying I should have. I wonder if. And, you know, the lady yelled, I have to sell my house. That was an open door for me. If you listen to people talk, they'll give you an open door. You can turn small talk into big talk in just a couple of seconds. They'll open the door. Sometimes they will come out and just ask you. We had a guy come clean our carpet one time. This is several years back. And while he was there doing that, I said to my wife, I'm going to go. We had a P.O. box. I said, well, I'm going to go check the P.O. box, check our mail. Let me back up. I was getting mail at the church we were at. I said, I'm going to go to the church and pick up my mail. And this guy lifted his head up and said, oh, what church do you go to? And I told him. And he said, I've been thinking about going somewhere myself. So I said, well, have you ever thought about being born again? Do you know what that is? Have you ever heard of it? He said, my cousin's talking to me about that all the time. I said, you know, I wasn't even looking for it. And there it was. God opened the door. He prayed with us right there, standing next to the carpet machine. Asked Jesus to save him. And then he started going to church. So these things are readily available anywhere. And God will help you. Well, if you want to start hearing God's voice, anybody want to start hearing God's voice? You want God, start getting involved in soul winning. Because that's what he's doing. He's involved in it, and he'll start speaking to you. He'll give you directions. I have had God give me, I'm not trying to cast bouquets at my feet like I'm Mr. Spiritual, but I have had God give me directions to somewhere, just like he told Ananias to go to, Peter, Ananias, whoever it was. What am I thinking of here? Go to Straight Street. Ananias, yeah. And you'll find what you're looking for there. So I've had God tell me to go certain places and look for certain things. Now, I believe he did that because he knew I would go and I would do it, and he's interested in getting people saved. I'll finish with this story. I was going down the interstate just past Wheeling, West Virginia, actually up to Morgantown, West Virginia. And I was riding in my car, and of course, on the interstate. And I started to pray, and I said, Lord, you know, I haven't led anybody to you in a long time. I repent. I ask you to show me somebody. Well, I thought it'd be a while, but immediately, just like he was sitting in the car, the Lord said to me, get off at the next exit, go to the Wendy's, and when you see the phone booth, you'll know that I sent you. Now, did I hear it audibly? No, but it was like on the inside of me. It was very clear. Spirit of God said, get off, go here. When you see that, you'll know I sent you. So I got off the interstate. I went to the Wendy's, which was about a half a mile off the interstate. I started looking for the phone booth, and I couldn't find it. And then, so I finally, after a while, I stopped in the parking lot, and I thought, well, that must have all been my imagination. You know, sometimes when God talks to you, it seems like it's you sometimes. And I thought, that must have been my imagination. So I got ready to leave, and I started walking back to my car, and then around the corner of the building in a certain angle, it's kind of hard to describe, over in the corner of the parking lot, I saw the phone booth. And behind the phone booth, about a block or two down the road, I saw a bonfire. And I knew that was what the Lord was talking to, because there are all these people down there talking to me about. And it turned out the Morgantown College was having a pep rally. They were going to play Syracuse. I had 10,000 tracks in my trunk I just ordered, picked up. And I don't know how many people were there, but the whole school turned out just about. And they were all around this bonfire, and they're all getting ready for this big football game. And I got there, and I started passing out tracks and passing them out. And here comes these three young Christians that saw me, and they said, we really like the track you, we were reading it, and I said, help me. And I stuffed tracks in their hands, and they started going around. And but before we got finished, I think we'd given one to everybody, because I was trying to hand them out, and they, I already got one. So we then started talking to people, and I think we prayed with about 20 people to receive Jesus. Now, the presence of God was as strong as I've ever felt it in any church before when we were doing that. I mean, God, the angels or whatever, they're all there. They're working with us. They're leading us to this person. They're leading us to that person. And it's just a very, very enjoyable experience. And about 20 people got saved right then and there, and then all these other people took something home to read. Now, a lot of Christians don't have a lot of faith in tracts, but they work. People take them home sometimes and get saved. At least plant seed. And you know, if you ever do that, if you want to start that way, get some tracts that have a prayer on them so they can pray and actually receive Jesus. Because, you know, so many of them say, believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved. Well, a lot of people are believing in him, like I said a while ago, though they haven't really met him yet. So a prayer helps on that. Anyway, God will start working with you. He will bless you tremendously. He'll speak to you. He'll give you directions. Because, you know, Jesus is the original Jew, and he likes to get fruit. And he took the guys in the fishing boat and told them where the fish were. And he'll help you do that too. He knows where the fish are. They cast the net over. They had plenty of fish. So I hope I haven't made anybody feel guilty. I didn't come here for that. I just know from my own life, you go out, set somebody. See, we have the chance to be heroes. When I first went in the ministry, the Lord, I said, God, what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do? He said to me, your mission is to rescue hostages. I love those hostage kind of movies. But you know, those people, they prepared themselves and they went. It wasn't just anybody usually in the movies that you see. And you hear stories. There were a couple kids that my son knows, they pulled somebody out of a burning car. It happened a couple years ago here in Port St. Lucie. I don't know, maybe you all read about it. And they were heroes. We get to pull people out of a burning hell. We have that responsibility and we get to do that. And it's an amazing feeling. It's an amazing thing to be a part of. And after you do it, you'll say, God, show me another one. Lead me to someone else. Hallelujah. Well, let's pray. Lord, we bless your name and we thank you. We do give you glory, Lord. We ask you, Father God, that you would help us to become everything you want us to be and do everything you've given us to do. Jesus, you kept saying you've got to finish the work, that you were going to be about your Father's business. And then you've trained people to help you do that. And you've been training people to help you do that. And this is the Father's business. And Lord, we're grateful to be a part of it. We're grateful to be shareholders in all this, Lord. We ask, Father God, that you would lead us to people. That you would make it easy for us, Lord. Some people in here, Lord, are already experts at this. Others have never done it, Lord. I pray that you make it easy for all of us. Lord, that you order our steps to the ripe souls, that you bring them to us. Lord, we ask for that in your name. fill our mouths as we endeavor to reach them. We believe you to do it. We believe you for your help, Lord. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Now, maybe you're in here with everybody's eyes closed. Maybe you've never been born again. Like I said, I went to church for years, and I hadn't experienced it. I think probably most everybody in here is, but maybe you're here and you've never been born again. Maybe you're not sure if you have been or not. Being born again is kind of like being married. You don't have to ask about it. You know if you are or not. If you don't have that assurance, it would be good to get that today. And, I mean, you don't have to be a Bible scholar to know we don't have a lot of time left. Things happening in the world, that are right out of the Bible. We want to be ready. If you'd like to be sure, I'm gonna pray a prayer with everyone, even while your heads are bowed, that we can just be sure, make sure of that. If you would like to do that, I would like for you to raise your hand. We're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to call you up here. I'm just going to pray a prayer so we can make sure this is done. We don't want any surprises on Judgment Day. Hallelujah. You know, if you're here and you're considering that and you're not even sure about any of this, you could find out if Jesus is real. I'll just give you this challenge. You can say, Jesus, if you're real, I want to know you. I ask you to reveal yourself to me. Do you mean